Careblazer, can medical treatments cause Alzheimer's disease? That's the question we're answering in this video, including, is Alzheimer's disease contagious? This comes as a result of a study that was published January 29th, 2024. It's January 30th at the time I'm recording this. So yesterday, this research study was released and it answers this question. Now, it's important to know a little bit of background. So right now, it has been thought that there are two ways to develop Alzheimer's disease. The first way is something the research field calls sporadic. This is the majority of cases of Alzheimer's disease, meaning they don't really quite know. There could be a genetic predisposition, like maybe somebody has the APOE4 gene, which raises their risk, but doesn't guarantee they're going to get Alzheimer's disease. It could be because of diet, lifestyle factors, exercise, exposure to toxins. Basically, who knows? That's the majority of cases, the sporadic. And people who have this type of Alzheimer's disease tend to get it later in life, typically 65 years old and later. The other type of way that people develop Alzheimer's disease is called familial or inherited, meaning the person has a gene that guarantees they're going to get the disease. This is the least common way to get dementia. This is one of those deterministic genes that no matter what lifestyle factors, if they're the healthiest person in the world, they're going to get dementia. When somebody has this type of Alzheimer's, it typically develops younger in age, younger than the age of 65. Well, this research study that was published yesterday has a potential third cause of Alzheimer's disease. And it has a funny name. I'll write it down for you. It's called, let's see if I can spell it first, iatrogenic. This is the third potential way somebody can get Alzheimer's disease. Iatrogenic basically means that it is acquired through medical treatment, through procedures, evaluation, and treatment. Now, there's many iatrogenic conditions. For instance, if somebody was in the hospital and they were laying in bed for a long time because maybe they're recovering from a big injury or a surgery and they didn't have a lot of strength, they might develop bed sores or pressure ulcers. Technically, that would be considered an iatrogenic bed sore or pressure ulcer because it was acquired in the hospital. You might also have heard the term hospital-acquired pneumonia, from somebody developing pneumonia from being in the hospital or developing an infection from being in the hospital. All of those are hospital-acquired. So iatrogenic, they got it in the hospital. So let's talk about how now they are thinking Alzheimer's disease can be acquired through hospital, through medical treatments. To give you some background, this might be hard to see, but these are more of my notes to help me remember. Between the years 1959 and 1989, 1,848 patients, children in the United Kingdom, received something called cadaveric human growth hormone. They received cadaveric human growth hormone because they had some sort of condition, like maybe failure to thrive or something. And so basically human growth hormone from cadavers was taken and put into these children to try to help them with some sort of condition. And what ended up happening is that 80 of those people, of those children, ended up dying pretty quickly, like within a year of receiving this human growth hormone. And they ended up dying because they developed something called Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or for short, CJD. Now, CJD is a rare brain disease that involves abnormal folding of proteins, a prion protein, and it's 100% fatal in everybody who gets it. And typically, the decline is pretty rapid and the person's dead within a year. And so 80 people who were in received this kind of growth hormone from the cadavers ended up dying. And what they discovered is that that growth hormone from the cadavers was contaminated with beta amyloid. And we know that beta amyloid is significant when it comes to Alzheimer's disease. When we look at the brains of people who have Alzheimer's disease, they have beta amyloid in their brain as well as tau. And so those people had this in their brain. It was contaminated. They ended up developing Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. disease, they ended up dying. In total, it's thought that there are about 200 total deaths documented from iatrogenic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, meaning they got it from the hospital from some sort of procedure. Pretty sad, right? Now, let's move on. When we look at the study that was just released yesterday, at the time I'm recording this, of the people who didn't die, basically there's a whole center, and what they do is they look at these people long-term who have been treated with this human growth hormone that was contaminated, and they're looking at them long-term to figure out what's going to happen to these people. How are they doing? So basically, they are referred to the clinic by other researchers, other clinicians to be studied long-term. This study that was just released looked at 8 patients in particular. And what they found was that of the 8 patients, 5 out of the 8 had early onset dementia. They were either 38 years old to 49 years old, with the exception of one of those 5 who was 55 years old. So really young to be developing Alzheimer's, which tells you it's not going to be the sporadic type of Alzheimer's disease, right? So one of them had mild cognitive impairment by the age of 42. One of them had subjective cognitive complaints, meaning they were reporting cognitive complaints but hadn't yet been diagnosed with anything official. And one of them was asymptomatic, meaning they weren't complaining of anything. They didn't show any clinical signs that something was wrong. However, when looking at their brain pathology was positive for Alzheimer's disease. So that's what's going on with these 8 people that were referred for further study who had initially been treated with that contaminated human growth hormone. Now you might be thinking, well, lots of people get Alzheimer's disease. Maybe they had the genetic predisposition for it. They had one of the genes that guaranteed they were going to get it. Well, the researchers took a look at their genetic makeup, their brain scans, all the other biomarkers available, and they've basically ruled out that this is due to them having a genetic predisposition or that it was some result of some other thing. Like, they basically ruled all that out, and they are really certain that these 8 people now have signs of cognitive impairment, the majority of them Alzheimer's disease, because of being treated with this contaminated beta amyloid from years ago, decades ago. So this was like 20, 30 years ago, these patients had received that treatment. So why should we care about this? What does any of this mean? Well, for starters, it means that a medical treatment actually led to Alzheimer's disease. That's what this research study is showing. Basically, by using contaminated human growth hormone with beta amyloid and injecting it into a healthy child, 80 of them ended up passing away within a year of getting Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. But the ones who are still alive are starting to come up with Alzheimer's disease in an unusual way, in uncharacteristic ways. Earlier age of onset, not having the genetic predisposition. So this is meaning we have to be very careful, and this is going to require hospitals, clinicians, researchers to think about what are their procedures to ensure that everything being used, from the tissues to the instruments, are totally sterilized, contamination free, so that when we're doing procedures on people, we're not actually making them at risk for getting Alzheimer's disease later on. That's pretty serious. This has not been documented ever before that you can get Alzheimer's disease from something like this. The other thing is that potentially this could lead to new research on how to prevent and how to treat Alzheimer's disease. Since we've never known Alzheimer's disease can come about in this way before, now this can prompt a whole door of opening of opportunities of, okay, let's talk about how this happened. What was the mechanism of this happening, and what research studies can we do that might give us more insight to how to potentially prevent and treat Alzheimer's disease in the future? What do you think? Are you surprised by this? I was actually really surprised by this, to think that it can be given through a medical procedure. Now, you might have the question, is it contagious? Can you get it from somebody else? Can beta amyloid somehow from somebody who has Alzheimer's disease, can you contract it as the caregiver? The answer is no. It does not transmit in that way. This is purely from a medical procedure, taking contaminated tissue and using it on another human being. So there's no need to worry about that. What do you think, Careblazer? I'm going to link the entire medical article, full text version, underneath this video so you can click on it and get your actual link and read everything yourself. But I'm wondering, are you wanting to be up to date on what the research is showing, new breakthroughs, new information like this. I tend to focus more on what would help you. Like what? How do you respond to the difficult behaviors? How do you manage caregiver stress? But it seems like a lot of you are also wanting to be informed about like what's happening out there, cutting edge, breakthrough right now. Would you like to see more videos like this in addition to what I've already been doing? Leave it in a comment below. Also, this is really important. Take a moment to hit the red subscribe button. And here's why this is important. When you hit the red subscribe button, for one, it communicates to YouTube that people like you are interested in videos like this. And so YouTube, being the smart thing that it is, will go out and find caregivers currently searching for information on dementia and put my videos in front of them so that they know there is help available. That's number one reason to hit the red subscribe button, which is free for you to do. The second reason is that I would love to make this totally free resource that I do, these free videos that I do every single week for you, I would like to make them more amazing, better, and actually get some of the amazing researchers and scientists to come on the show and have conversations with me, with you, about what's happening in the field. Like I could potentially contact one of the researchers from this study and have them come on the show and talk to us about it. But in order for me to attract high caliber scientists, research clinicians in the field of dementia, I have to show them that this is a channel where people are interested in hearing that information. So the more people who are subscribed, the more likelihood that kind of person will come on the show and share with all of us. So it really is important. It's not a vanity metric. It's not so I can be excited about some sort of number. It's really about making this channel better for you. It's 100% free to do. I really appreciate it. If you want to join us inside of the Care Course where we talk about all this stuff in depth, we have support groups, we have new programs. There's also a link in the video below that you can check us out and join us. We would love to have you. That's all I have for you right now, Careblazer. I'm sending you so much love.
Also, Nico gets a belly rub for every person who subscribes from this video. So if you haven't already, click the red subscribe button. It's totally free. And Nico says, thank you very much.